Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Slap in the Face, Why Insults Hurt and Why They Shouldn't, by William B. Irvine, narrated by Johnny Heller. Chapter 1. Introduction. In the 1920s, a group of writers, editors, critics, and actors were in the habit of meeting for lunch at the Algonquin Hotel in New York City. They sat at a round table in the hotel's restaurant and, preferably over martinis, swapped witticisms. Playwright Mark Connolly was a member of the Algonquin Round Table, as the group was known. One day he was sitting at lunch when another man came up behind him, rubbed his hands over Connolly's bald head, and said, "Mark, your head feels as smooth as my wife's ass." Connolly reached up, felt his own scalp, and, without missing a beat, replied, "So it does, so it does." This is a delightful example of repartee. An insulted person quickly turns the insult back on the insulter. This bit of repartee was sufficiently witty that we are still repeating it 8 decades later. In other cases, the consequences of an insult, rather than being humorous, are horrific. In 1996, for example, Ronald Schonneberger's girlfriend refused to cut short a cruise to come comfort him when his father died. He felt sufficiently insulted by this refusal that he apparently hatched a cold-blooded plan for revenge. He married the girlfriend, had a child by her, and allowed sufficient time for her to bond with the child, all so he could kill the child. He suffocated it with plastic wrap. Doing this, he thought, would make the woman understand how he felt when his father died, and thereby make her appreciate the gravity of her failure to comfort him at that time. Notice that in this case, what Schonneberger took to be insulting wasn't something his girlfriend said, and wasn't even something she did. It was something she failed to do, namely, cut her cruise short. Notice, too, that the girlfriend might not have intended to hurt Schonneberger's feelings. To the contrary, she might simply have been thoughtless. We should not make the mistake, then, of thinking that only intentionally hurtful remarks can count as insults. Rather, if you find my behavior to be insulting, I have insulted you, perhaps without intending to do so. Insults are ubiquitous. It may be uncommon for a boss or teacher to insult us by calling us a fool in public, but insults from friends and relatives are commonplace. They might tell us that the glare from our bald head is ruining the group photo they are trying to take. Or they might tell those present, as we are paying for their dinner, that such generosity on our part is astonishing and suggests that we must be experiencing the early symptoms of food poisoning. Curiously, friends and relatives say these things not because they want to offend us, but because they like us and want us to like them in turn. Indeed, if we take offense at what they say, they will be surprised. "We were just teasing you," they will explain. Another form of insult is simultaneously more subtle and sinister than this. Suppose I tell you that a mutual friend has told me that you are a pompous fool. The friend has clearly insulted you, albeit behind your back. But besides this insult, there might be a second and arguably more malicious insult. Consider, after all, my motives in telling you about the friend's comment. It could be that I did so for your own good. I wanted to let you know that you should not trust this friend. It is also possible, though, that my motives in reporting the insult are anything but benevolent. I might have wanted to inflict the pain of an insult on you without myself being the author of that insult, and therefore without laying myself open to retaliation on your part. Indeed, if I dislike you, hearing someone insult you behind your back is cause for celebration, inasmuch as it presents me with the insult equivalent of a free lunch. An examination of insults gives us valuable insight into the human condition. We are people who need to be among people. The problem is that once we are among them, we feel compelled to sort ourselves into social hierarchies. If we were wolves, we might accomplish this with a series of fights. Whoever defeated all comers would be the leader of the pack, and whoever was defeated by all would be the last to eat, if any food was left. But we are not wolves. We are instead creatures who have evolved oversized brains, and we have used these brains to develop language. As a result, we don't need to use our teeth or fists to sort ourselves into social hierarchies. We can instead use words, strung together to form insults, and so we do. Turning our attention to the historical record, we find that as long as humans have possessed written language, we have used it to insult each other. Thus, in the Old Testament, we find individuals complaining to God about having been insulted. I am a worm, not a man, abused by all men, scorned by the people. All who see me jeer at me, make mouths at me, and wag their heads. We find advice on what to do when insulted. A clever man slighted conceals his feelings. We find people insulting the Lord. Remember, O Lord, the taunts of the enemy, the scorn a savage nation pours on thy name. And we find Jeremiah reporting what the Lord told him regarding Israel. Do you see what apostate Israel did? She went up to every hilltop and under every spreading tree, and there she played the whore. That an omnipotent and perfectly good being would feel the need to insult mere mortals says something about how tempting it is to use words to inflict pain. Among the ruins of the city of Pompeii, which was destroyed by a volcanic eruption in 79 AD, we gain further insight into the role insults played in the ancient world. Among the graffiti found on the ash-entombed walls of the city, someone carved Lucius Iscodicius. I regard as a stranger anyone who doesn't invite me to dinner. This comment reveals that in ancient Pompeii, you could insult someone by failing to invite him to dinner. It also tells us that one way ancient Pompeians responded to insults was to give someone the cold shoulder, to treat him, that is, as a stranger. From a distance of nearly 2 millennia, this instance of hurt feeling seems ridiculously petty, and yet we need only look around us to find instances of people in our midst, and possibly even we ourselves, being similarly hurt by similar social oversights. Notice that in the case just described, the offended person decided to inform Lucius Iscodicius of his offense in an anonymous manner. There would have been, after all, a great many people Lucius had failed to invite to dinner. The graffiti leaves him guessing exactly which uninvited individual wrote it. Notice, too, that instead of sending an anonymous letter to Lucius, the offended person posted a graffiti that could be read by everyone. He apparently wanted the world at large to know of Lucius's shortcomings as a host. At about this same time in nearby Rome, the Stoic philosophers were analyzing insults and the role they play in relationships. We find Seneca listing the insults directed at him. Someone openly laughed at his conversation. Someone at a party made a joke at his expense, and someone spoke ill of his writings. Much has changed since Seneca's time, but these would all still count as insults. I will have much more to say about the Stoics later on. As we shall see, they possessed remarkable insight into the psychology of insults, and as a result, they are a source of valuable advice on how best to deal with them. Moving on to Elizabethan times, we come to what some would call the golden age of invective. In Shakespeare's King Lear, for example, Kent calls Oswald a knave, a rascal, an eater of broken meats, a base, proud, shallow, beggarly, three-suited, 100-pound, filthy, worsted, stocking knave, a lily-livered, action-taking whoreson, glass-gazing, super-serviceable, finical rogue, one trunk-inheriting slave. And after, one hopes, pausing to catch his breath, Kent goes on to describe Oswald as, among other things, a beggar, coward, pander, and the son and heir of a mongrel bitch. Curiously, although many of the words used in them may be obsolete, Elizabethan-style insults are still with us. There are several sites on the internet that will, at the click of a mouse button, generate Elizabethan-sounding insults by stringing together, in semi-random fashion, words of disapproval that were common in Elizabethan times. One such site obligingly labeled me a gore-bellied elf-skinned lewdster. And if this insult did not sufficiently offend me, it claimed to have 388,943 other insults available that might do the job. Modern insults generally aren't as colorful or verbally adroit as Elizabethan insults were, but they nevertheless manage to carry a sting. Writers tend to be clever people with fragile egos and are therefore a good source of insults. Thus, we find Truman Capote's acerbic assessment of the works of Jack Kerouac. That's not writing, that's typing. We find Elizabeth Bowen characterizing Aldous Huxley as the stupid person's idea of a clever person. we find James Dickey declaring that, if it were thought that anything I wrote was influenced by Robert Frost, I would take that particular piece of mine, shred it, and flush it down the toilet, hoping not to clog the pipes. Politicians are another good source of insults. It isn't that they, like writers, have fragile egos. If they did, they couldn't withstand the stress of campaigning. Rather, they insult political opponents because they realize, as H.L. Mencken put it, that one horse laugh is worth 10,000 syllogisms. During an election year, voters are consequently treated to an avalanche of slung mud. We find Abraham Lincoln suggesting that an argument propounded by Stephen A. Douglas is as thin as the homeopathic soup that was made by boiling the shadow of a pigeon that had been starved to death. We find William Cowper Brann invoking his dog to insult William E. McKinley. Why, if a man were to call my dog McKinley, and the brute failed to resent to the death the damning insult, I'd drown it. We find Jim Hightower characterizing Dan Quayle as being so dumb he thinks Cheerios are donut seeds. And Barry Goldwater asserting of politician William Scott that if he were any dumber, he'd be a tree. And across the Atlantic, we find Winston Churchill characterizing Clement Attlee as a sheep in sheep's clothing, and as a modest little man with much to be modest about. If insults can be amusing, so can people's responses to them. Indeed, many insult connoisseurs, myself included, would argue that the highest form of insult is repartee. We've already encountered one example of a quick, witty, and insulting reply to an insult, Mark Connelly's quip about his insulter's wife's derriere. For another example, consider actress Ilka Chase's response to Humphrey Bogart, when, after telling her how much he had enjoyed her most recent book, he asked, "By the way, who wrote it for you?" Chase, annoyed by the suggestion that she had employed a ghostwriter, had the presence of mind to offer the following rejoinder. "I'm so glad you liked it. By the way, who read it to you?" I became interested in insults while doing research on the Stoic philosophers. They spend a considerable amount of time, as I have said, thinking about insults and how best to deal with them. I thought this was an odd thing for philosophers to do, but ultimately concluded that they were on to something. If one role of philosophers is to teach us how to have a good life, then it is entirely appropriate for them to ponder insults in the role they play in human affairs. After all, insults have the power to make us miserable. As a result of reading the Stoics, I became a collector of insults. I started paying attention to the insulting things other people say and do. Blatant, vicious insults, I discovered, are rare. Blatant but benign insults, though, turn out to be commonplace. People use them, as I have said, to tease friends and relatives. I also found that insults can be easy to misconstrue. What sounds like praise, for example, might in fact be a cleverly packaged insult. In the course of my investigation of insults, I made a disturbing discovery. I myself was the source of many insults. For one thing, I became fully aware of how many blatant, albeit benign, insults I unleash in the course of a day. It is not unusual, for example, for me to tease friends. Thus, I might playfully refer to a taciturn friend as a chatterbox, and he might respond again playfully by referring to me as the absent-minded professor. But besides these playful insults, I discovered that I am the source of other more sinister ones. I would analyze conversations I had only to realize that some of the things I had said could best be understood as subtle attempts to put other people down. In one such case, a student told me of his plan to pursue graduate studies and asked what I thought of the university he would attend. I replied that the university in question was a real bargain, as graduate schools go. It was only later, when I replayed the conversation in my mind, that I realized that I had, albeit obliquely, belittled his choice of schools. For one thing, my response implied that the school he would attend is where you go if you lack the money for a proper education. My response, in other words, expressed a degree of educational snobbery. It was clear to me, in afterthought, how I should have responded to this person's announcement, and how I would have responded if I were a better person than I am. I should have congratulated him on achieving what for him was a significant life goal. Not only that, but the congratulations in question should have been heartfelt. And what prevented me from offering sincere congratulations? I must have felt that my own status as an intellectual was somehow threatened by his going to graduate school. How utterly foolish, I thought, and felt more than a bit ashamed of myself. I may be the only person on the planet to engage in this sort of ego defense and petty social jockeying, but I don't think so. We all want other people to know and appreciate how wonderful we are, and one way to accomplish this is by making them realize how relatively insignificant they are. And so we go out of our way, often subconsciously, to inflict subtle insults that will put them in their place. It is obvious that we insult someone when we intentionally cause him pain by something we say or do, but we also insult him when we cause him pain by something we refuse to say or do, such as refusing to shake his hand, or even by something we fail to say or do, such as forgetting to thank him for a gift. Indeed, as we shall see, it is not only possible but surprisingly easy to insult other people in the act of attempting to praise them. If our goal, then, is to go through life causing the least pain possible to those around us, it is important that we gain a deep understanding of insults. More generally, if we wish to understand the human condition, we would do well to investigate insults and the role they play in human relations. In our investigation, we will want to answer a number of questions. Why do we insult each other? Why are insults capable of causing us such pain? Is there anything we can do to prevent or lessen this pain? And perhaps most important, how can we overcome our propensity to insult others? It was with these questions in mind that I wrote this book. Let me make it clear at the outset that this is not an insult book in the ordinary sense of the phrase. Rather than being a book of insults, it is a book about insults, about the psychology behind them and the social role they play. In part one of this book, I describe the insult arsenal, beginning in chapter two with blatant insults, such as when someone walks up to you and calls you a fat, lazy toad. In chapters 3 and 4, I consider more subtle forms of invective, such as when someone insults you by failing to remember your name or by praising you in a manner in which you don't want to be praised. And in chapter 5, I consider benign insults, such as those involved in playful teasing. These are unleashed not because the insulter wants to hurt his targets, but because he wants to maintain a social relationship with them. In part 2 of this book, I investigate the science of insults. More precisely, I turn to psychological research in an attempt to answer 3 important questions. How much do insults hurt us? Who are they most likely to hurt? And why do they hurt? To answer this last question, I turn to the research of evolutionary psychologists. These scientists, as we shall see, maintain that we insult each other in large part because of our evolutionary past. Our ancestors, who insulted others and were hurt by the insults of others, were more likely to survive and reproduce than those who did not, and we modern humans have inherited their psychological propensities. After this scientific interlude, I turn my attention in part 3 to the advice that has been offered and how best to respond to insults. After describing the various possible responses, I defend the Stoic assertion that the best way to respond to an insult is with no response at all, and that if we feel we simply must say something in response to an insult, we should respond with words of insult directed not at our insulter but at ourselves. We should respond, that is, with self-deprecating humor. I go on to consider Stoic advice on how to remove the sting from an insult and thereby prevent it from upsetting us. I also investigate the ways in which society has tried to discourage insults by, for example, adopting codes of politeness and outlawing hate speech. The goal of this book, then, is not to teach people how to insult others, although as a result of hearing it, someone may indeed become more skilled in the art of invective. Nor is it the goal of this book to teach insult self-defense, to teach listeners, in other words, how to quickly and effectively respond to an insult with a counter-insult. Rather, the goal is to help listeners understand insults, the social role they play, the reason we are inclined to insult others, and the reason it hurts when they insult us. On gaining this understanding, listeners might notice, as I have, a change in how they respond to insults. An insult that once would have ruined their day will have lost its sting, and rather than triggering feelings of anger, an insult will trigger feelings of pity toward the person who insulted them. listeners might, as a result, discover that their insult reflex, their habit of responding to an insult by insulting their insulter, has atrophied. Likewise, they might notice that they are unleashing fewer first-strike insults against people who have done them no harm than they formerly did. It is also possible that as a result of pondering the social function of insults, listeners will experience a significant personal transformation. Many listeners will have picked up this book because they seek a cure for insults. They seek, that is, a prescription that will alleviate the pain caused by the insults directed at them. By the time they finish this book, though, listeners might realize that the pain caused by insults is really just a symptom of a far more serious ailment, much as a nagging cough, although itself distressing, can be a symptom of a potentially fatal disease. Listeners might also come to realize that in order to increase their chance of having a good life, they should, rather than simply seeking a remedy for the pain of insults, take steps to cure the underlying ailment that causes insults to be painful. The Stoic philosophers, as we shall see, thought they understood this underlying ailment. They maintained that we insult and are in turn hurt by insults in a large part because we have chosen the wrong values by which to live. From this, it follows that we can eliminate the pain of insults and, even more important, increase our chance of having a good life by choosing the proper values. In chapter 11 of this book, I will examine in greater detail the Stoics' cure for insults. And in the chapter after that, I will describe the insights I have gained in my own efforts to effect this cure. Here, in a nutshell, is the predicament in which we humans find ourselves. We are wired by our evolutionary past to find some things pleasant and find other things unpleasant or even painful. In particular, we are wired so that we find it unpleasant to live in social isolation, and so we seek the company of other people. Once among them, we find it unpleasant when they look down on us, socially speaking, and quite pleasant when they look up to us. And so we set out trying to raise ourselves on the social ladder. One of our primary ladder-climbing tools is the insult. The problem is that the people with whom we deal have this same wiring, and as a result, we enter into a social contest with them. The Stoics did not know about the evolutionary wiring I have described, but they understood full well our need to be with other people and the social strife that would ensue when we joined them. It was with this in mind that they developed strategies that would let us enjoy the benefits of human interaction while avoiding much of the pain such interaction could cause. In this book, I will attempt to reconcile the ancient wisdom of the Stoics with modern scientific research into human behavior. Part 1. The Insult Arsenal. Chapter 2. Words Like Daggers. As anyone who has been hurt by an insult can tell you, words can be used as weapons. Let us then begin our exploration of the insult arsenal. By the time we are finished, listeners will appreciate not only the many roles insults play in human interactions, but the considerable ingenuity that has been invested in their creation. Let me preface this exploration with some caveats. To begin with, realize that in the discussions that follow, I am using insult in a very broad sense. The dictionary defines an insult as an offensive action or remark. Thus, insults need not be verbal. They can instead involve actions. They can, for example, involve gestures, such as showing someone your middle finger, or they can involve physical contact. This contact might be direct, as when you slap someone, or it might be indirect. If you spit in someone's face, it will be your spit, not you, that comes into contact with him. Furthermore, when a physical insult involves indirect contact, the contact in question can be quite unsubstantial. Suppose, for example, you blow cigarette smoke in someone's face, or belch in such close proximity to her that she can tell what you had for lunch. In these cases, your insult is transmitted by mere molecules. The insults just described require us to do something, such as call someone an idiot or blow smoke in her face. It is important to realize, though, that the action that constitutes an insult can be a failure to act. Indeed, it is not only possible but surprisingly easy to insult someone not by anything you do but by what you fail to do. Thus, if someone wants or expects to be invited to a party you are giving, and you fail to invite her, she will likely feel insulted. The dictionary goes on to define offensive actions and remarks as those that cause anger, resentment, displeasure, or affront. This means that it is possible for something we said or did to count as an insult, even though it was not our intent to insult someone. In particular, even though a man didn't intend to forget his wedding anniversary, and even though his wife realizes as much, she might nevertheless experience displeasure at the oversight, in which case his behavior will count as insulting. It is also possible for us to insult someone by saying something undeniably true. Suppose, for example, I walk up to a bald friend and tell him truthfully that a turkey vulture has more hair than you do. If the remark causes my friend displeasure, it will count, according to the aforementioned definition, as an insult. Indeed, even if it is unreasonable for a person to be displeased by what we say, we will, if we displease him, have insulted him. It is important to keep in mind that insults are relative. Thus, words or actions that count as an insult in one culture might not count as an insult in another. In America, for example, you will insult no one, well, almost no one, if you fail to take your shoes off when you enter her house. Do this in Thailand, though, and you will grievously insult your host. Likewise, words or actions that count as an insult in one subculture within, say, America, might not count as an insult in another. If, for example, you like the motorcycle someone has built or the tattoo he has acquired, you might please him by calling it sick or bad. If, however, an art teacher at a retirement home likes a student's watercolors, it would be unwise for her to refer to them as sick or bad, since the meaning of these colloquialisms would be lost on retirees, and they would therefore take offense. And even within a subculture, whether or not something counts as an insult depends on how sensitive an individual is. A hypersensitive person will be insulted by almost everything we say, but a thick-skinned person will be very difficult to insult. Furthermore, whether or not something counts as an insult depends on the circumstances. The statement, "You are talented and pretty enough to be Miss Montana," said to someone who has just won a beauty pageant in some tiny Montana town, will count as praise. Say the same thing to someone who has just won the Miss America beauty pageant, though, and your remark will probably be construed as an insult. Likewise, if a stranger sits down next to me on the bus and I don't speak to him, it won't, unless he is hypersensitive, count as an insult. But if a neighbor sits down next to me on the bus and I don't speak to him, it almost certainly will count as an insult. Although what counts as an insult differs from culture to culture, the concept of insulting behavior is universal. It is rare to encounter a human being whose feelings cannot be hurt with a few well-chosen words. It is also rare to encounter a human being who has overcome the temptation, when the opportunity arises, to subject those around him to insults. Before we humans acquired language, we presumably insulted each other with gestures, body language, or physical contact, the way monkeys do in their attempts to gain social dominance with their troop. The acquisition of language, though, made it much easier for us to insult one another, and with the invention of writing, we gained the ability to insult people at a distance by sending them an insulting letter or, these days, by creating a website full of insulting comments about them. The discovery of verbal insults tipped the odds, socially speaking, in favor of those who lack physical strength but possess a quick wit. Instead of using their fists to socially intimidate others, they could use words that are, as one psychologist has noted, as easy to deliver as the flick of a tongue. They can also be as cutting as daggers. The most basic kind of insult is the person-to-person insult. You might first have experienced this sort of insult when you were a child and a sibling called you a dummy or a crybaby. As you grew older, you discovered all the different ways it was possible for one person to insult another. A person insulting you might have attacked you by commenting on your appearance. You are fat, your motives, you are mean, or your character, you are lazy. As you reached adolescence, your enemies might have attacked you by commenting on your past. You are a bedwetter, or your sexual identity. You throw like a girl, said to a boy. Athletic competitions are often rife with person-to-person insults as players talk trash to their opponents. Their goal in doing this is not to scar these opponents emotionally, rather it is to get inside their head, to fluster them, and thereby cause them to play poorly. There was a time when talking trash was considered poor sportsmanship. Muhammad Ali, or Cassius Clay, as he was then known, changed all this. Before, during, and after a fight, he would make belittling remarks about his opponents. Before long, other professional athletes started imitating Ali, and not long after that, amateur athletes followed suit. This trend has continued over recent decades, and as a result, we have reached a stage at which the good sportsmanship that used to be ubiquitous on fields of play is on the verge of extinction. Those wishing to insult someone might engage in name-calling. They might, for example, alter the spelling of his name. If Bob puts on some weight, his buddies might start calling him Blob. Or they might give him a nickname by adding adjectives to his name. He might become Big Bob. Or they might abandon Bob's real name altogether in favor of a new name they think is more fitting. If Bob tries to boss his buddies around, they might start calling him Little Hitler. If he lacks the mental wherewithal to graduate from high school, they might start calling him Einstein. And if he refuses to do the foolish things they want to do, they might start calling him Sally. Parents and teachers are fond of telling children that although sticks and stones can break your bones, names can never hurt you. One suspects, though, that the adults in question would find it more than a little upsetting if one of the children with whom they shared this adage responded by saying, "Sure thing, bozo." A more useful piece of advice for parents and teachers to be passing along, then, would be something like this. Sticks and stones can break your bones, but you should develop a strategy to minimize the pain you experience when people call you names. This advice, I might add, anticipates the advice I will be giving later in this book. Besides insulting Bob by literally calling him a name, such as Sally, Bob's friends can insult him in a metaphorical manner. They can call him something he clearly isn't. They might, for example, call him a chicken, an ass, a dog, a baby, a walking donut, or a whore. Indeed, they can insult him by labeling him to be the exact opposite of what everyone knows he is. If, for example, Bob is a proud teetotaler, they might call him a lush. And if Bob's friends are good at mimicry, they can insult him by mocking the way he walks, talks, or swings a golf club. Along similar lines, they can, if they are science-minded, honor him by naming a unit after him. They might, for example, adopt the Bob as a unit of ignorance, which would let them say that a mistake someone made was two Bobs dumb. A quick check of the internet, by the way, shows that naming units of ignorance after someone is a popular pastime. Someone has, for example, suggested that we adopt the Stallone, after actor Sylvester Stallone, as the unit of ignorance. Elsewhere, a mathematician has dishonored a coworker named Moore by suggesting the adoption of the moron as the unit of stupidity. The insults described here require a degree of wit and effort. It is possible, though, for even a witless, lazy person to insult someone. He need only add a disparaging term such as dummy to the things he says to her. Thus, instead of simply telling his sister that it is time for dinner, a child might say, "It's time for dinner, dummy." One might think that intelligent, articulate individuals would feel no need to insult other people, but they do. They disguise this need by carefully couching the language they use in their insults. Suppose, for example, that after they present a paper on the works of Nietzsche at an academic conference, someone in the audience asks a question that reveals what looks like a critical flaw in the presenter's argument. In this case, the presenter is unlikely to call the questioner a big dummy. He might instead reply by saying, "It is clear that the questioner has not read the works of Nietzsche carefully." The academics in the audience will immediately recognize that the speaker has just called the questioner a big dummy, but has done so with style and elegance. Besides verbal and physical insults, there are what might be called quasi-verbal insults. These insults are not verbal in the strict etymological sense, inasmuch as they do not employ words. They do, however, involve the production of noises. A person might, for example, make a farting sound with his mouth or sigh audibly while someone else is trying to talk. He might laugh or snort in reaction to something someone has said. If he is at a public performance, he might insult the performer by whistling, booing, or hissing. It is also possible to insult someone with a gesture. Such an insult is not verbal or even quasi-verbal, since it involves no production of noise. Nor is it physical, since it involves no contact, not even with something as unsubstantial as cigarette smoke or the fumes of a belch. Among the arsenal of insulting gestures we find the bird, also known as flipping someone off or giving him the finger, making faces, sticking your tongue out at someone, for example, rolling your eyes, and smirking. And besides insulting someone with gestures, we can insult him by other things we do with our body. We can, for example, pretend to fall asleep while he is talking. We can step on his shadow, and if he is a stranger, we can stare at him and refuse to look away when he makes eye contact with us. Within the arsenal of insults, we find curious subcategories. Consider, for example, curses. One curse, said to be popular among gypsies, goes like this. May you wander over the face of the earth forever. Never sleep twice in the same bed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.